The last major function of EQ in a mixing context is for, of course, blending it all together. So this is your classic mix or console EQ application. And I just want to make this point here up front that if you have three EQs on a track, that's totally okay. I'd prefer for you to ask yourself the question of, do I need to do any fixing? Do I need to do any enhancing? And do I need to do any blending? If the answer is yes to all three, use a separate EQ for each purpose. And this is where people a lot of times in the mix, they blindly throw processors because they just think they need them. But if you boil it down to specific purposes, it really helps focus you and really helps actually with your mix. So if you listen to a part, you go, oh man, I really need to high pass this. Okay, I'm going to put on the TDR Nova. All right, I really want to enhance this. I'm going to do something special with it. I'm going to go with the PT EQX. And then when it's blending time, you might go, okay, this sounds like it could use a little bit more separation from this other part. Let's go with the TDR Vos Slick EQ. And this would be, for the blended purpose, what you would expect on an actual mixing console. You don't see a mixing console with five channels of an API EQ and then five channels of an SSL EQ. It just doesn't make sense. It doesn't add to the cohesion of the mix. And part of that, you know, quote unquote, special sauce or X factor is the cohesion factor, is making sure that everything sounds like it's all run through some of the same processors. And that's part of the whole blended idea. So with the moves that you make, it's all about listening and making a lot of subtle moves, which at the end should hopefully make a big impact. And remember here too, because we have that enhanced stage, we don't need to worry about any extreme or drastic moves. We can really make this very subtle, and that's why it's all about context, and more context, really listening closely and asking yourself, is a blend appropriate here? Do I need to create separation? And if the answer is yes, then you go with the blend. If the answer is no, it fits perfectly, you don't necessarily need it. But the whole reason and point of using the same EQ over and over again is because it's rare that you're going to get a production where every single sound just marries perfectly together. It just doesn't happen because there's just not that secret or perfect recipe out there in sounds and sample libraries and so forth. So you're listening to hear for space, really. Does each part occupy its own unique range in the frequency spectrum? And if things are overlapping, can I enhance this in one way or another to add more separation, to make sure that the really important part remains the really important part? So it's up to you to determine that hierarchy of this part takes precedence over this part, and your blending EQ is going to respond accordingly. The other question you need to ask is, where is the fundamental, or where are the fundamentals? So with a percussion sound, or let's say it's a kick drum, it's just the same thing. It's boom, 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 boom. You can pick out a fundamental and you can enhance it, and you can add a fairly sharp cue and put a couple dB there. But what you can't do is take a piano that's playing over six octaves and say, I'm just going to enhance the fundamental. Well, the fundamental varies. And so if you are going to be enhancing the fundamentals of a particular part, make sure you listen and hear how much of a range that actually takes up, and then make your broad cue accordingly. Okay, or make sure that you're working with a setting that has a fairly broad EQ resonance curve. Yet again, we're going to ask, what type of EQ should I use? And this is just one opinion. This is the way I look at it logically. Some of you may disagree, and that's totally fine. But just like an actual mixing console, you want to be consistent. Yes, a lot of different EQs in theory will add additional separation, but probably not the way you want. So when the EQ is taking on a character of itself, if you have six or seven different EQs and each of them has its own unique character, you're adding separation, but you're losing cohesion at the same time. The beauty of the blended EQ is that you can use the one EQ to make those frequency separations that you need, but also then bring it all together because it's going through the same processor, thus this idea of mix cohesion. So with what we have available, I would say the best option would be to use the TDR Slick EQ consistently in one of the various modes and with the same type or sort of saturation. You can drive in the saturation differently if you want, but you could leave that consistent as well, and hopefully then that will add a sense of cohesion to the overall mix. So let's jump back into the DAW and look at a quick example of this. Here is where subjectivity and working with a slight hand makes all of the difference. So here's an example that we have.
Farewell, but whenever you welcome the hour that awakens the night song of birth in your bower.
Okay, that's our example. So let's say that I want the poem to be the major point of emphasis here in the mix. And I'm listening to this in context with everything else. And I say, okay, that piano's a little bit too loud. Let's get the balance right first.
Farewell, but whenever you welcome the hour that awakens the night song of birth in your bower.
The next thing I might tell myself or ask myself is, okay, this is really essay. I should probably go in and fix that. And of course, we can use the TDR Nova to get really fancy with it. But in this example, I'm just going to use the TDR Nova as a fix-it EQ, and I'm going to use a low-pass filter to try and get some of that essiness out of this guy. So,
farewell, but whenever you welcome the hour that awakens.
Put it on the wrong track. Let's put it on the poem instead. We all make mistakes.
Farewell, but whenever you welcome the hour that awakens the night song of birth in your bower. Farewell, but whenever you welcome the hour that awakens the night song of birth in your bower.
Okay, so by doing that one move there, by doing the fix-it move, what have I also done? If you listen closely to the overall tonality, like the timbral aspects of these two parts, the piano and the poem, I would say now we actually are losing separation because we're bringing both into more of this lo-fi kind of dark, eerie, mysterious quality. And that's what happens when you get rid of like high frequencies. So I now have to ask myself, do I need a blended EQ? Do I need to do something a little bit more to bring that separation back? And there's not a right answer to that question, okay? That's the important part here is you could get away with...
Farewell, but whenever you welcome the hour that awakens the night song of birth in your bower.
That right there would be totally acceptable. And because we only have two instruments here, it's really easy. But the problem might be by pulling down this piano, I'm now losing it in the mix. So again, it's all about context, listening to everything together, how they relate, how they work together. The other thing is if I look at the span of both of these parts, and we'll start with the piano.
Farewell, but whenever you want.
This is the frequency spectrum and area that it occupies. And if I look here on the poem.
Farewell, but whenever you welcome the hour that awakens the night song of birth in your bower.
Fairly similar. Maybe it's a little bit brighter. Obviously, it goes up a bit higher. So I know that I should be able to add some additional blend, but it's not something that I would have to do. However, in this example, we're going to do it so that I can illustrate the point and the subtlety of this. All right, so if you're a beginner, working with the span, working with the analyzer is definitely helpful. Eventually, you'll get to a point where you can just use your ears. But if you need that span for a little bit of guidance and help, don't be afraid to use it. You're not breaking any cardinal sin or anything. So I'm going to bring in a Slick EQ on both of these guys. And I want to make sure that I'm working with the same setting. So I actually do want to work with American. And for my output stage here for my distortion, let's go ahead and go with mellow because the mood of this is quite mellow with the piano and also with the poem. Okay, so I'm not going to touch anything else right now. I usually don't leave the auto gain enabled. And the American mode, I like it because you get pretty broad and pretty broad slope on the cue, which is what I'm looking for. And that's normally what I prefer when I'm doing a blend function anyway. I don't really want anything too sharp. I want it to be nice and broad and nice and sort of subtle and not all that obvious of places where I'm putting in EQ bands. So what I'm going to do is I want the vocal to be the thing that stands out. So with the vocal, we know that the fundamental...
Farewell, but whenever you welcome the hour that awakens the night.
It's more in this 200 or 400 range. I think I'm going to emphasize the 400 range. Let's see how that sounds. Bring this up to 400 or so. So I'm using the option or control key here to move around.
Farewell, but whenever you welcome the hour that awakens the night song of birth in your bower. Farewell, But whenever you welcome the hour that awakens the night song of...
The other thing I want to do is I want to brighten this up just a little bit more. So I could maybe use a high shelf, but I think I'm going to try to find a frequency that works well for clarity here. So let's try 2.5K.
Farewell. But whenever you welcome the hour that awakens the night song of mirth in your bower. Farewell. But whenever you welcome the hour that awakens the night song of mirth in your bower.
So 6.3 K actually seems to be a little bit better, a little more airy, a lot of clarity here. And let's listen to this now.
Farewell. But whenever you welcome the hour that awakens the night song of mirth in your bower. Farewell. But whenever you welcome the hour that awakens the night song of mirth in your bower.
Okay, I'm liking the changes that I've made there. And then what I would do with the piano is, again, with similar moves here, I'm going to go in and kind of do the opposite. But I am going to put a little bit of gain here somewhere where we didn't put gain. So maybe I would do that at around, maybe around 1K.
Farewell. But whenever you welcome the hour that awakens the night song of mirth in your bower.
Turn the saturation on.
Farewell. But whenever you welcome the hour that awakens the night song of mirth in your bower. Farewell. But whenever you welcome the hour that awakens the night song of mirth in your bower. Farewell. But whenever you welcome the hour that awakens the night song of mirth in your bower. Farewell. But whenever you welcome the hour that awakens the night song of mirth in your bower. Farewell. But whenever you welcome the hour that awakens the night song of mirth in your bower.
So the benefit of this, of using a small amount of blend and really thinking about how these two pieces are going to fit together, what I can actually get away with is turning the piano up a little bit more, but still establishing that difference between the two parts and keeping the poem as the major point of emphasis. And that's really what I was trying to accomplish with the blended EQ. And so it can be very subtle, and you know, you don't want to do anything too extreme here, but you do want to hear the difference. And if you're a little bit new to mixing and you don't really have maybe as keen of an ear to making those subtle small adjustments, then make the larger, bigger adjustments. And over time, you'll start to actually hear that you're going too far, and then you'll start to pull back. So this is all part of this learning experience throughout everything that we're doing here with making music. And so don't be afraid to go a little bit harder on it if you aren't hearing a difference. Like, I'm definitely hearing a difference with what I've done with both of these. And if we were to bounce this section out,
farewell, but whenever you welcome the hour that awakens the night song of mirth in your bower. Farewell, but whenever you welcome the hour that awakens the night song of mirth in your bower.
So I went ahead and I just bounced the two of these because I want you to hear them back to back. And I was saying, if you're struggling with actually hearing the difference or hearing the subtleties, then you just have to kind of experiment and practice. But here is with EQ.
Farewell, but whenever you welcome the hour that awakens the night song of mirth in your bower.
And then here's without it.
Farewell, but whenever you welcome the hour that awakens the night song of mirth in your bower.
And so you might prefer one to the other. You might prefer the non-EQ version, which is fine. But I think with the one that is EQ'd, you can hear that separation just a little bit more. And that's why it's all about subtlety. So if you do that all the way across the mix, where you're hearing things are possibly clashing with one another, you are going to open up a lot of space, you know, add that little extra bit of dimension, and then give yourself more wiggle room with all of the additional processing that you're planning to do. So that's the idea with the blended EQ, and now you have a pretty good understanding of the three major functions of EQ in a mix.